This week at NASA. The twin gravity recovery and interior laboratory spacecraft, formerly known as GRAIL-A and GRAIL-B, have new names.
Give me an E!
E!
Give me an F!
F!
Give me a B!
B!
Give me an O!
O!
Give me a B!
B!
Give me an O!
O!
Give me an N!
N!
Give me a W!
W!
What have we got?
The students at Emily Dickinson Elementary in Bozeman, Montana, announced the new names, Ebb and Flow, live on NASA TV after winning a nationwide contest to rename the spacecraft.
Science is such an abstract study, so being part of naming something makes it real. It gives them ownership and real involvement in the space exploration.
They noted the fact that GRAIL is going to be studying gravity on the moon, and that the effect of gravity on the Earth is seen every day in terms of tides that we have on the Earth. So they chose Ebb and Flow because it was the daily example of how the moon's gravity is working on the Earth.
Ebb and Flow have been flying together in orbit around the moon since New Year's Day, collecting data designed to create a gravity map of the moon. Their mission will enable scientists to learn more about the moon from crust to core, thus providing a better understanding of its origin.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present the future home of Atlantis.
The Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex hosted a groundbreaking ceremony for the facility that will feature Space Shuttle Atlantis. Plans for the 65,000 square foot building include treating visitors to imagery of the space shuttle in flight, up-close views of Atlantis, and details about how the spacecraft functioned in space.
Atlantis's mission in space is over, but its mission to inspire generations of potential space travelers is just beginning. And this facility will no doubt attract hundreds of thousands over the coming years.
While construction is underway on its new home, Atlantis continues its transition and retirement processing in a hangar at KSC. The new Atlantis display is scheduled to open in 2013.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to JPL on the 14th annual Invention Challenge.
When the Invention Challenge first started 14 years ago, it was just a competition of engineering creativity between JPLers. Now, local middle schools and high schools have joined the contest, and the student teams outnumber JPL teams 3-1.
The Invention Challenge this year was to build a machine that could kick a football over a barrier and into a can. Simple. We'll see how simple it is.
Each team got 3 tries in a minute to kick a football into the trash can. If it made it, the team got 50 points, 30 points if it hit the rim, 25 if it hit the side, and 10 points if it bounced inside the circle around the can.
All right, contestant ready.
Ready.
Spotters ready.
Ready.
Timer's ready.
Ready.
3, 2, 1, go!
We were the first JPL team up. We're a little nervous, and it went in 3 times in a row. The high school kids, I think there's about 4 on the board right now that have gone 3 for 3. I hope we don't have to compete against them, because their machines are way better than ours.
The student team competition ended in double overtime and 2 sudden death kickoffs.
Ready, 3, 2, 1, go!
Culver City High won with a rim shot.
What sort of lessons are you going to take with you?
Simple is always better.
Oh yeah.
Duct tape is the best.
Today we faced a lot of challenges. Some of the stuff on our project broke, like the laser level we're supposed to use, so we had to just adapt and try to play through it.
I think what we're trying to show is that engineering can be fun, and we hope that the students that like this kind of an event pursue it, because we really want to produce the next generation of engineers.
Astronaut Cady Coleman made several appearances in the Cleveland area, including the International Women's Air and Space Museum. Coleman, who has logged more than 4,300 hours in space, spoke about her two missions aboard Space Shuttle Columbia, as well as her 6 months on the International Space Station with the Expedition 26-27 crew.
And I think that a museum like this, where we make history become real, we realize that history is made by real people, and in this case, real women, it enables us to understand that we're part of making history too.
Coleman was joined by astronaut Greg Johnson, now Associate Director for External Programs at Glenn. Johnson piloted two missions aboard Space Shuttle Endeavour, including its final flight in the spring of 2011 on STS-134.
If you've ever wished upon a star, or at least wished you could keep track of the shooting stars you see in the night sky, there's now a new mobile application just for that. NASA's new Meteor Counter app for the iPhone, iPad, and iPod Touch allows star watchers to record data about meteors they see, including their numbers, sky location, brightness, and the specific time they were spotted. You can even record comments about the sighting. Users can then send all the info to NASA for use in identifying new meteor showers, pinpointing comet debris streams, and mapping the asteroids orbiting Earth. A new exhibit at New York's American Museum of Natural History depicts the past, present, and future of space exploration. Featured among the display of dinosaur bones and other artifacts usually displayed in a museum of natural history is the work of the Hubble Space Telescope. HST has unlocked countless mysteries in space while providing links to understanding more about the past here on Earth.
The Hubble Space Telescope is looking at the natural history of the universe. When we use the Hubble, we're able to look back in history, not the few thousand years or the few million years of what the rest of this museum talks about, but the billions of years, the history of how the chemical elements that made the dinosaurs were created.
I think it's a great way for us to get the word out about what we're doing. I think particularly with the space shuttle program ending, a lot of people are thinking that, you know, NASA is not necessarily that active anymore, and we really are.
On January 24th, 1986, NASA's Voyager 2 spacecraft made a successful flyby of Uranus, returning about 8,000 images of the planet and its moons. Both launched in 1977, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 have explored all the giant planets of our outer solar system. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, 48 of their moons, and the unique system of rings and magnetic fields surrounding those planets. Decades and many billions of miles later, both Voyagers are continuing their journeys to the boundaries of the solar system. January 26th is NASA's 2012 Day of Remembrance. On this day, we honor the 17 astronauts of the Apollo 1, Challenger, and Columbia crews, as well as the other members of the NASA family who lost their lives supporting the agency's mission of exploration. Once more, we thank them and the families they left behind for their sacrifices in the service of our nation. And that's This Week at NASA. For more on these and other stories, log on to www.nasa.gov.